Yeah, I was just about to present.
We are waiting. Our presenters are here. I think what we'll do is we'll wait for five more minutes and just let everybody join back. We did overrun our time for the morning session, so this must we'll give 5 minutes more. I think there were couple of things. I think Tanvi had written that we need to look at different formats and things like that, and we are going to be touching upon that on our fifth day, and that building construction is not restricted only just to what after we share what we are doing, but we hope that eventually you go back, everybody goes back with the idea of bringing changes to what we are doing in our studios, make them more vibrant. So last session that Himanshu Pandita and Himanshu Sangani presented actually was the whole gamut. It looked at literally all aspects. While Prashansa presented the syllabus and the connections between the different semesters, and I think what we will do now in the present session is look at some parts of things in detail, which again with tomorrow's sessions will again be more of the same. We will concentrate on different things. So this coming session is on bringing value to our construction studio, and we will look at aspects of this whole technology and the digital technology in tomorrow's session, morning session. For the morning session, also I'll request everybody, if you're interested, so for the morning session, request everybody to go to sketchup.com if they do not have the software, because the presentation that Sangani and Pandita showed about was a lot of it was done in SketchUp, and it's a very easy tool. So we want to at least give this basic steps about SketchUp and also share some advanced level tools for SketchUp. So whoever knows SketchUp, they will also get something they can take back. And see, there are going to be certain overlaps. Because we are talking within this subject, and we are talking from different point of views, certain things will be brought in. So I think that is and request everybody to join in. People have been very active. They've been writing on the chat, which is lovely. But at some points when we ask you, we stop the presentation. Please feel free to jump in, have a dialogue, because I think so by discussing, by putting what we are doing, and also this will help us also to know what is happening. I mean, we are sharing what all we are doing, and we are bringing our learning out there. And that's exactly how we looked at this program. It's not a one-way street, and that's the issue with most of FDPs is that I think the best thing is when we can have a sharing of experiences, and we can bring it all out there. So I have talked for 5-6 minutes. So we should be ready to start our session. So without much ado, I'm going to just jump in. And Ashwini sir did speak in the last session a bit. And Ashwini Kher, he is a professor and a design chair at SSA AU, Ansel University. He is Amrita, you were presenting. Do you want me to present? Okay, I'll present. Not an issue, I'll present. Yeah. Okay, Amrita is presenting. And he's a senior, he's a guide. He teaches us all the time. I mean, us faculty all the time. So he's a pass out of the 77 batch from Chandigarh College of Architecture. He has more than 40 years of professional experience, including prestigious projects. Many hotels, including Aga Khan award-winning Mughlai Sheraton, Agra, several urban and industrial housing projects. We look up to him and we go to him, and he comes and he's one of the warmest persons within our faculty group. So we have Ashwini sir. Then we have Shiv Marwa. He's a practicing architect, a gold medalist from SPA New Delhi. He has been working on principal design and planning consultations for institutional, industrial, and transport projects. Design, renovation, and upgradation of educational infrastructure continues to be a major area of work, and with special emphasis on functional, sustainable, and and replicable models for the rural and underprivileged students in India. Shiv Marwa is visiting with us, has been visiting with us. He's been teaching the construction studio for a long time. He brings to the table to this forum today a lot of his experience. And we have Ashish Agarwal. He is a practicing architect. Ashish Agarwal graduated from SSA 1996. He has been running his own architectural interior design and project management practice in Gurgaon since 1995, after having worked with SM Bagley and Associate and Studio Parallel, New Delhi. He's also visiting with us. He's been teaching a number of subjects besides building construction, project planning, professional practice, or masters in interior architecture. Ashish Agarwal, in fact, is not looked at as a visiting at all. He's a part of our core faculty, literally. He's there, and we reach out to him. And so I think over to three of you. Yeah. So can we have your videos on? Ashwini sir, Ashish?
Yes.
Request you to switch on your videos.
Take the lead, Chief.
Shiv, you're on mute.
Thank you, Aruna, so much for your warm welcome. And it just feels that back to the school, back to the class.
Yeah, but you are the teacher here.
We all are.
And sometimes not a very happy feeling. Sometimes it's a very happy feeling. So it's a mixed bag, I would say. Okay, good afternoon everybody, and since I am beginning, I would just like to apologize for any of the things that you hear and which may just put you off to sleep. because I am not talking numbers, I'm not talking details, I'm not talking software, I'm not talking construction as construction. I'll be talking more esoteric, talking more in terms of the value that we can create or the value that should be created or collectively what best we can do.
I think, sorry to disturb, Shiv, maybe can you just explain the structure of the whole session?
Yes, I will do that. Yeah, I will do that. I will begin with talking about the value systems and the values that we need to create for our students. After me, Ashwini sir will be talking about the various other issues, and he'll talk about the fact that we want to actually make construction technologists, which is also the title of this particular session, rather than just people who are copying or making details without understanding. So it's like design in construction. And we'll conclude by Ashish's talk on attitudes and what can be done about what can be done to change the attitude of students. And even if we can't do anything, we start analyzing what are the problems, so that building construction is not looked at a subject which is supporting or which is just also running while we're doing our design. I think in the morning session also, and yesterday also, this was made amply clear that building construction and design, they actually move hand in hand. Somewhere design takes precedence and somewhere construction takes over, depending on the kind of project. So these kind of attitudes and the students, how they react to these things, Ashish will be touching upon. Now, so let me start with the presentation. Can I do that from here? Do I need some permission?
No, you can do that. Yeah. Would you want us? Okay, fair enough.
No, that's it. Can you see this now?
Yeah, we can see.
Is it visible to everybody? All right.
Yeah, it's visible.
So the title for today's session is Creating Construction Technologists. That's basically the gist of it. How do we do that? We can do it by adding value. We can talk about design and we can talk about attitudes. So this discussion is actually going to be about the attitudes for building construction. There could be methods, outputs, communication, feedback, whatever, so we can, and please feel free to interject, to ask questions, because collectively we are looking for answers. We should be able to solve some of these issues and try to find an answer or the way forward. So please stop me wherever you feel that I need to be stopped, if I'm running over time or whatever. One of the things that I feel very often, and I am also guilty of quoting this every time, is that students respond if they see value. Most of the time we say construction is a subject where children are not so much interested. They are kind of burdened by design. They're burdened by something else, some other submission. And they do it because the subject is important. They have to pass in this and they do it and then move on. So when we talk about value, there are, again, this happens, operates at two levels. The first level would be, and this is in my experience, that if you actually offer value to students, they respond very well. It could be a class which is probably notorious for not listening to their professors, or it could be a very studious class. So they respond according to their capabilities, but then they do respond. And when we say creating this value, we are actually looking at two different levels. The first level could be, which I'm sure everybody and all the faculty members strive in their own individual capacities. You always want to be able to provide maximum for the students, whatever best you can do. So this is at an individual level. You keep improvising, you keep looking at different methods of engagement with students, different methods of feedback, and so on and so forth. Everyone may have their own specific methodology to look at that. But what I'm talking today is actually about creating value at an institutional level. So which is built into the process, which is built into the whole system, and everybody is mandated to follow that. If we collectively manage to do that, we will be able to have these students who are great in understanding, in their understanding of the subject, not just construction, but the whole architecture, all the other aspects of architecture, because they understand the underlying fact that, you know, if you know how to identify a problem and how to solve it, the method, the routes could all be different. But then if you know that process, and then you are fine and you are readily employable. Anybody who comes out from the college also, when he applies for a job, and most often than not, the employers are looking at their construction document, and then they say ki aapko ye nahi aata, you know. So why? Because probably that's following the standard system, that this is how you have to make the drawing. But if we were to actually go beyond that and figure out a methodology where we train the students to be able to identify the problem and then solve it in whatever way they want to do it. Prashansa has already talked about the syllabus, and then tomorrow also there's going to be more discussion on the software. So without restricting ourselves to a particular tried and tested system, we should also as faculty members start exploring. And if we do that institutionally, if we do that with a plan, I think that will be the best way forward. Rather than these some sparks here and there, let's have the whole fire burning. So why do we need it? What is this value? How do we do it? The whole, everything leads down to one aspect, which is better understanding. And we kind of develop these, we make these keen students as keen learners. And that is extremely important. If they understand everything and if they learn well, we are fine. We've done our job well. So this value creation pedagogy is actually when teachers let students learn by applying their competencies. You know, students pick up some competencies as they go along from first year, from second year, third year. So they have some competency. They even have competencies to look for information left, right, Google, ask friends, ask seniors, ask parents, ask professionals, whatever. So they have some competencies which are either existing in them or which are also future competencies to create something of value. You know, they use these competencies to create something of value. Again, so students need to understand, they need to be told again and again that whatever you're creating is not just a sheet for the sake of submission. You're not just making this for sake of midterm or for end term. You are trying to create a value. And at the end of the semester, even if they understand one thing perfectly well, that is your job done. So they create something of value to at least one external stakeholder. This becomes extremely important here, that, you know, among the students, who are the stakeholders when we are talking to students? So the stakeholders are students in that case. For us, they become the stakeholders. But for students, they are going to be like future professionals. They are the architects of the future. For them, the stakeholders could be the clients, the contractor, the state. They could actually think in terms of creating value for the nation. They could think in terms of what will help the contractor, what will help the client. And these are the kind of values which we need to start imparting. When we talk to the student, we should be talking about the application. We should talk about critical thinking, even creative development. Why? Because this would help their future client. This would help their future contractor. This would help the country. And the value that the student creates for someone else can be economic, social, and cultural. So they need to understand that there are, wherever you are there and where you are a funnel or you're a conduit in the whole process. So you are using your skills of critical thinking, creative development, and application to create a value for a client, contractor, or anybody else. And that value is more like an economic value for the contractor, economic value for the client, social value for people who are using that. So identify these stakeholders and see what kind of value this creates. If we can do this in any of our design problems or in our construction problems or structural issues or structural design, wherever, whichever subject, even history and theory of design, if you look at any this process, and students start realizing how important they are, and they can't just mess with the process. They have to know it, because they are wholly responsible for what is going to come out of their studio or their drawing sheets. So if they understand this process and they understand how important they are, that is what will make a difference. That will drive them to do better. The problem today, I feel, I wouldn't say a problem, but then this could be a issue also, that our students don't feel so important, that they don't understand their importance and their role in the construction process. And not just physical construction, but construction, because whenever we say construction, I'm sorry, this is a building construction FDP, so I'll be using construction word more. But when I say construction, it also means that whatever is the design is your build form shapes a lot of other actions, and it molds the thinking of people who are using it. It makes a lot of difference to its final users. So if our students who understand that by their activities, by their thinking, by their creativity, they can create a value and they have a long-lasting impact on the society. I think it's very important that we need to make them feel very important. And if you feel important, you will behave more responsibly. You will try to do it well. That's what all architects, finally, when they start their own practices, have to. They face the moment they get the first project, because they are wholly and solely responsible for everything that is going out. And they suddenly become a lot more diligent, they become a lot more aware of things, and that's what we need to do when we create this value. I've already discussed the second slide with my previous slide. So the kind of value that we are creating and integration with the subjects. So you look at building construction, structures, building service, they look at an economic value creation. You talk about project management, you talk about design, that gets into your influence value creation. There's a value creation for which is harmony value creation. And there we look at history, we look at settlement, we look at so many other aspects. Similarly, architectural design, theory of design, they get into social value creation. And once you have done all this, you get to a level which is enjoyment value creation. And students are actually in the middle of it. So they need to figure out which side are they leaning more, because not everybody looks at design similarly. Some people may look at it more from a design, if I may say, and some will look at construction, you know. So there are different aspects which students like or dislike, or they lean more towards it. So they can pick up their area or their own area of interest or their niche, and they make a niche in that and they move on. But ultimately everything leads to an enjoyment value creation. They start enjoying their work, which again becomes very important. So they become important, they feel important. Secondly, they start to enjoy their work. And this can happen once we have these integration from all the subjects. You know, if you look at it, I don't know if you can see this. So you have these fingers, so you have these different subjects coming here, and they ultimately come and merge here. That works the best, and this is where the student is right in the middle. That person can then decide which side is more important, whether he wants to lay more emphasis on construction, structure, services, theory, history, whatever. So again, also lot depends on the kind of project you're doing, but then they need to be made aware of all these things. So they need to feel important, they need to start enjoying. These are two things that we've covered till now. The third, now, you know, if you look at this creation of value, I've used this as an example, that if we were to make an external wall section through the building, let's say that's the output, which is required as per syllabus, we need to make external wall sections. So there are these different five steps or five different levels at which we can engage with the students. So the first, this one, is that the first one is that, you know, we, like a normal class, you provide typical details and students make very beautiful drawings. Hello, am I audible? I am getting no feedback, so I don't know whether I'm
Audible. You're audible, huh? Shiv, continue. And when you're going to be running out of time, I will barge in.
Okay, no, I'm only seeing my screen. I want to see some of the people also around. How do I do that?
Then you let us present.
I think you do that, please. Can you do that? That it's getting a little... So I will release, stop presenting. And I'll take a break for a minute or so.
Okay.
So, when I was talking about these various steps, you know, first step, as I said, is like typical instructional teaching, that you provide details, you make detail on a board, students copy it, they make it, and then they make nice drawings, and that's the end of the story. We go one step ahead, let's say, you know, let's, because we are trying to create value, understand, I'm using the context of external wall section so that we all understand what I'm trying to say. The second step could be, which is also done, if you brainstorm problems, what could be a problem with this? What could be a problem with foundation? What could be a problem with plinth protection? And, you know, what could be a problem with roof waterproofing? So understand these 3-4 typical details and you know, because that's, again, part of the syllabus and you need students to know at least about this, if nothing else. So discuss these and then follow the age-old detailed method, which you can see in some of the books, which we have learned while we were in college so many years back. They still manage to percolate in our network with the children. So that is another way of doing it, okay, which is slightly better than the first one because you are discussing some problems. The third step would be that we engage with students very actively. And when I say very actively, it means that engagement doesn't mean that we're just talking to them. We are actually doing a dialogue. So the system that I have been following for some few years is that you give a skeleton and then the students do it themselves on the board. They develop it on the board, wherever are the problems. So they kind of become critiques to, like they critique each other's work, you know, without getting the fact ki koi kya bolega, but we do those exercises in the class where everyone is talking, everybody gets an opportunity to speak. So we engage students by actively involving them in questioning and actually stimulating their mind. And you can ask all kinds of questions. So something someone does wrong, you can ask them. Someone does something which is right, you can still question them. You know, so we start engaging with them. And when you start engaging with them, when they go back to the drawing board and when they start drafting it, you know, they will recall that discussion again, and then they will start solving the problems. Next step would be enable, you know, experiment with systems, materials, and try to solve the issues using a mix of conventional new technologies. Now, when you've explained the problem, then step number three, you take them to one step ahead and say that, okay, these are the problems. How do we solve them? Somebody may want to do a mud fresco on the roof for waterproofing and insulation. Somebody may use something else. There could be different technology. Somebody can just plan a detail where you don't need this. You can work out some other membrane on top. So there could be different methods, different technologies, which as faculty sometimes, you know, we also may not be aware. And I think there's no harm in shying away from the fact that it's not that the faculty knows everything. You as a good faculty would basically drive a student to get the right answer. And, you know, there's a saying which says that if you don't know the answer, at least it's always better to know a person who would know the correct answer. That's what we used to say in college, that मुझे नहीं आता लेकिन मुझे पता है किसको आता है, उसकी शीट से निकाल लो. सो समवेयर यू नीड टू गाइड देम इन अ वे एंड गेट देम टू थिंक एंड व्हेन वी एंड अगेन दिस हेल्प्स मी इफ यू रिकॉल माय प्रीवियस टू स्लाइड द स्टूडेंट्स फील दैट दे आर इम्पोर्टेंट दे आर इम्पोर्टेंट पार्ट ऑफ द होल सिस्टम बिकॉज दे आर थिंकिंग नाउ दे आर यूजिंग देयर क्रिटिकल थिंकिंग स्किल्स टू फिगर आउट व्हाट वर्क्स व्हाट डजंट वर्क. And also, you know, take them to next step, which is empower. So, which is like self-evaluation process. Now, I may make a brilliant design. I can do what, make very, you know, this complicated sheets, which Prachansa was talking about in the morning session. So, we can make all those sheets and we can do all that. But then if the person who's supposed to read those drawings, if he cannot make out anything about it, so the whole process is defeated. So, this is where you bring in your self-evaluation process. And peer review. Normally, peer review is done at, you know, master level or PhD level, where you are required to do that, where you need to talk to others and take their feedback also. So I'm saying we bring that, a little bit of that, in the architectural education, right at the second year, third year, whichever stage. So, you know, that's something we can discuss later. So that evaluation becomes very important. And all of us know that when we have to evaluate somebody, you need to be very clear of the standards that against which you are evaluating. You know, if I'm giving 10 out of 10 to somebody, I know what I'm expecting from a person who is perfect. If somebody is getting 5, then I know, in my head, I know what are the things that are missing in this person's work. So moment you start doing evaluation, you start getting your basics right. You start getting your standards right. You know what is negotiable, what is non-negotiable. That in this particular work, if this is not done, then everything else is zero, no matter how pretty the drawing is. So we just need to look at, if we were to look at this five-step system and apply this methodology in all the subjects, or even in construction, in whatever detail we are doing, whatever work we are doing, be it steel, concrete, or understanding of materials, I think this will take us to a good level where our students start thinking and start evaluating. And if they start doing that, then also our job is done. Next slide, please, Amita. So how to engage, enable, empower students. These are nice, interesting words, but I think three E's we can all remember: engage, enable, and empower. And this is for students, not for faculty, please. So we need to engage students, we need to enable them, we need to empower them. And some of these are, you know, what I could write, I could think was, we emulate real life practice scenarios in classroom. We actually treat it like an architectural practice. We develop problems that encourages students to think like professionals. And that is, again, that becomes important. We need to, you know, even the problem formulation even should become very creative by itself. We need to get into a lot of role play. So faculty could behave like a client and pose difficult questions like the clients ask us. Faculty can even behave like a structural engineer and they can impose instructions, lot of limitations to design, lot of limitations to what they are doing. So faculty can then behave like a site engineer. Ki mujhe to aata nahi sir, batao isme kya karna hai, ye to aapki drawing mein ye missing hai. Faculty can behave like contractor. Isme se aapki ye hai, main paise kaise banaunga. You know, so if we expose students to these different kind of pressures right in the studio while they are doing a particular topic, a subject, I think they get to understand all facets and they start thinking more creatively. That is very important. You know, they need to keep thinking laterally, thinking whatever direction they want to think, but then they need to start thinking and question everything that is being told to them. And which is actually enabling them and empowering them to look at projects, look at work more like a professional. And then they can document and self-assess their learning, including the feedback. You know, I'm saying feedback, not just for the work, but feedback even for the faculty, that you know that these are the, this is how, what, this is what we have learned, this is what could have been done better, and maybe, you know, we in the next session or whenever that happens, we could take them over to a look at their feedback and try to improvise our strategy. Next, please. So what can faculty do? I'm not talking about what students can do in this. This is FDP, and so it's all about faculty. We allow several differentiated paths up to the mountain for learning that are demonstrable, you know, which I think I talked about this earlier also, that there could be different methods of approaching a particular solution, a particular issue, and there could be different methods, different methodologies, different materials, and we should be able to demonstrate that rather than saying this is the only detail which is possible. This is only how you do your waterproofing for the basement. This is what you do for fixing a window. You know, if there are these diverse opinions, diverse ideas, we as faculty need to motivate us, our students, and let them ask these questions, and we should be able to demonstrate that, okay, if you want to do this, let's do this. If you want to follow this system, isse bhi ho jayega, but isse hame ye karna padega. So it's always, and also not always a one-size-fits-all approach works. That's what I'm trying to say in the first three bullet points here, that because I've been doing something from the last 10 years doesn't mean the 11th year also I will have to do the same thing. I may have to change, I will have to change, and I will have to look at newer methods of explaining the same thing to students. And students, I can tell you, are so intelligent and so bright. Whenever, when it comes to avoiding work, or when it comes to, you know, quickly wrapping up things, they are very smart. We need to learn from them how to wrap up work so smartly. And there was, I'll just break into a quick anecdote here. And we were doing this toilet detail in a particular session. And for, you know, over the years of practice and everything, I feel that system works very well for students to learn, and even for the contractor who will implemented. So I have a system that, you know, we draw like this, you do this, we do this, we do this. This is how we compose a sheet. This is what is required. This is a set of information which is required, but this is what it is done. Now, so there was this one student who was absent, you know, who bunked that first half of the class and came back in the second class with a drawing of the toilet perfectly as I had explained in the first half. Now, he was not in the class and he got this drawing because, how did he get the drawing? Because he had friends in the previous, you know, the senior years, and he got that drawing from them, and because I was the common link between the last year and this particular batch, the drawing was copied. And you know, but the drawing was copied, and I was like, it was a wake-up call for me. You know, next time I am going to change my system and I will not teach like this. The next class, that when we do toilet detail, we will do it differently. Just for the sake of being different, I will still make it more difficult, and I will make it different so that I don't have these problems of students taking from here and there. So you know, we need to keep improvising. We need to keep looking at the way we teach. And then try different instructional strategies, which could be case-based learning. You know, you can have a case study base. You can have multiple and varied representation of concepts. You can have collaborative and connected learning. So students can form groups and, you know, they can work out detail. Again, some of the pictures which Prashansa had displayed in the morning session of the trusses and those, you know, connection of steel connections. So all of them had the same. Members, but everybody designed the detail differently. So that was collaborative and connected learning, which is all again peer to peer. So which is again very important, that somebody within the group says, "Nahi, aisa nahi hota hai, isko aise banate hain." You know, they listen to each other, they understand the importance of working in teams. And then of course apprentice internship opportunities, and you know, they become self-directed, it become more personalized. All these kind of things, you know, we need to bring these things, these values in ourselves so that we can impart these values to our students. There was a very interesting quote which I've put in the bottom of the slide, which says the aim of the teaching is simple. It is to make our student learning possible. To teach is to make an assumption about what and how the student learns. Therefore, to teach well implies learning about students, students learning. So how they are learning, and if we can teach them how to learn, I think that's what teaching is all about. We can not cram them with hundreds of details and hundreds of drawings. They will eventually find their own path, as long as they know how to develop that their own detail, develop their own style of working. And that becomes important here. Next slide, please. So when I was talking about the institutional value system, you know, what I told you till now was more like as an individual faculty, what we all try to do, whatever best we can do within the circumstances, within the limitations of the hours and everything and that we have. But if we institutionalize the whole process, then it may just add up to actually having a good set of employable students. Now, if you look at this learning needs, this says learning needs to become process oriented yet flexible. And if you look at the bottom arrow, it says two, and in two of these boxes it says faculty, and one of them it says students, which means the role and the emphasis and the import, the I would say responsibility is more on, is twice on the faculty than the students here. The students part is only, you know, for faculty, they need to design those kind of tasks. They need to have the correct inputs. You need to have the correct methodology of assessing and even application of concepts and how effective they are. So once the teacher does his or her job well, the students can then, you know, take that responsibility. And the responsibility taking, when that value comes in the student's mind, I think that becomes very important. They need to start taking responsibility. They need to start owning up things. And that can only happen if we, all of us, also start doing the same thing. And we actually inculcate that value as a process. You know, it's from first year to fifth year, they finally become responsible student citizens, they who understand the importance of what they are doing. They feel happy, they become important, they feel important, they take responsibility. The three values I've covered till now. Let's go on to the next slide, please. This was they're like a little far-fetched, but no harm talking about this. If you consider for a moment that as architects who start their own practice, or as any of these entrepreneurs in the new age world, what are the values that they have? And this is more like a life, more of a life skill, entrepreneurship, rather than you know, a management skill. So if you look at this skill, and people who become successful entrepreneurs, they have very strong methods of doing things, which have developed over the years with their experience, or it could be acquired learning, or it could be learning which they've gained from their faculties or from colleges they went or whatever. Second part is interaction. So they know how to interact. They can interact well, or they learn how to face those different kind of interactions. Third part is competencies. So they develop competencies. If you look at the competency, it's not as big as the methods. Again, these sizes are what I feel. I could be wrong, and we can have an open session on this if anybody feels differently. So they can have, a good entrepreneur actually has very good methods, can have good competencies, learning, and is constantly learning, because you just can't stop your learning and then say, okay, now I'm done for the next 50 years. You need to keep improvising. And that's what I said earlier also. And the last part, which is very important, is delivery. So if you can be the brilliant, most brilliant person, you can be the best of designer, best of construction technology, but if you can't deliver in time, if you can't deliver what is expected out of you, and whatever is your delivery, if that doesn't help people on ground, that cannot help, you know, you can't make a building out of it or whatever you want to do, everything else is useless. So we need, so the, if we can, you know, create entrepreneurship as, think of this as a skill which we impart to our students, and talk about these five aspects here. There could be many more, but I thought these are more important. And if we could fix these and start giving them a dose of these in every session, every year, every class, every lecture, so then it becomes institutionalized, where we know that the whole college, the entire faculty system, everything is getting them up to become entrepreneurs, rather than, you know, getting out of the college looking for jobs or whatever. And we should have equipped them with enough skills that they are on their own the moment they get out of the college. They may or may not, that's their choice, but then we need, as a professional course, we should be able to equip them with these skills. Something like what doctors, you know, you pass your MBBS and you can go and set up your own clinic. You may not have the experience, but then you have the skills. Similarly for chartered accountants or for lawyers, and like any other professional course, an architecture, being professional, we should also have these students who should be able to start their own practice and not be dependent on employment from other architects or other places, and, you know, don't get paid so much, and then the whole cycle starts and brings a bad name to the profession. So I think that we should seriously think about bringing entrepreneurship as a skill for our students. Next, please. Amrita, next, please. Yeah. So this slide is something which I would want others to react. So when we say, you know, what is the direction that we are taking? There could be these four different kinds of learning, which is experiential learning, progressive education, classroom education, and traditional education with books, knowledge, which has very high academic session standards, lectures, and, you know, you have people from, so when you're in a college, you're in a cocoon, you don't know what is happening outside, and you have these are the books, this is what is syllabus, you learn this, do well, get good marks, and you become a good student. But again, being a professional course, we have to engage with people outside. So we talk about experiential learning, we talk about progressive education. And the theme of these progressive education, experiential learning, is that you are actually exposed to problems outside. You do your teamwork, you do your problem solving, you're social, there's active learning which is happening. And in building construction, this becomes very important. You know, you just can't teach them on the basis of theory. Theory is fine, you know, you need it. But ultimately, they also need to go move over to the other side, you know, diagonally over there, which is experiential learning and progressive education. Can you just, Amrita, just go on to the next question? Yeah, so if you look at this red rectangle here, ideal would be this. You know, this is an ideal situation where everything is balanced, the student knows everything, student exposed to everything. But then this, we all know this doesn't happen. This takes a lot of time, and it cannot happen. This is an utopian situation. The next one is what usually happens. You know, you have a high mix of classroom education and traditional education with some experiential learning thrown in and some progressive education also thrown in. You know, some colleges do it less, some do it more, some do a lot of hands-on, some don't do it. So this brown rectangle can then vary. But essentially, it leans towards the southeast quadrant and not goes toward the southwest and not goes toward the northeast. We move on to the next one. So these are different examples. You know, then this blue thing is some colleges and some courses have a lot of experiential learning also. So they do an equal mix of experiential and traditional and classroom and, of course, bit of progressive, because when you're doing this, you gradually move towards progressive education. So we, and the next one, please. There could be another extreme that there are some who are looking at very high level of progressive and experiential learning, and which tapers down towards the traditional education system. And the last one, I think that's the last one. Yeah, that's the rhombus. If we can, you know, this the length on this axis can change, but if we have a right mix, probably again depending upon the vision of the institute, the vision of where you want to peg ourselves, and say that, you know, we are a college, we take pride in actually having students who can get out and do whatever in the field they know best, they know everything and whatever. So whatever be our pitch, we can decide this rhombus ourselves. And if we can figure out this collectively, I think we know what is the way forward, what should be the strategy of, you know, teaching the students. How do we guide them? How do we do mentor? How do we mentor these students? So I, you know, would request all of you to just look at this thing for another half a minute or something, and maybe on your own notebooks, wherever you are, you can have your own little shape. And if you could share the shape with us, we can do a more meaningful discussion post all the sessions are done. So that's a little homework if somebody wants to do it. The next slide, please. So when you do that previous slide, you know, you kind of fix your playing field. That's what I call. You fix your playing field. We say, you know, so building construction, you can't just say that you are in one particular quadrant. You need to have a mix of everything. If it's only teaching, if it's only classroom and no experiential, then that building construction doesn't work. If you only do construction experiential and with no classroom, because you don't know what the right standards are, you don't know what the right details are, you don't know what the right methodologies are, then also it's wrong. So it has to be a mix of everything. Now this X, Y, Z that you see at the bottom, this is what we have to, again, as collectively, we should be able to fix this, that how much percentage of traditional system is what is required, because traditional system bring in your simplicity, it's more individual, content driven, it's kind of detached from everything else, and theory, which is also required, like you can't do without it. The second part is experiential learning, which is again simplifying and more self-driven, and students learn to take responsibilities, effective, because they are actually working with their own hands. The last part is progressive education, which is complex, social, lot of processes, engagement with the stakeholders, and then finally practice and delivery. So we need to bring in the right proportion of all this, and based on that proportion, we can again frame or reframe our learning outcomes and deliveries from each of these courses. This is more true in the case of building construction. Maybe in other subjects, in history probably, the first traditional classroom system may become little higher and something else may come down. For construction, the latter two become higher. So again, this can vary, but this, we can use this formula for any subject that we want to do. Next slide, please. This is another flow chart for student engagement and faculty guidance. And if you don't look at it like an ellipse, think of it like a spiral, that you start from I'm using my mouse. We start from this part where it's let students learn. So that's our aim. We start, let students learn, then, you know, by applying their future and existing competencies, which I've discussed in the first slide earlier, to create something nice, novel, which is valued to at least one external stakeholder outside their school, university, group, or class. Now, when you look at this spiral, this cycle, and then from once they've done this, then they move over to the next level. You know, not necessarily a semester, but within a semester also, there could be two or three of these cycles which are running, and keep developing this. So this becomes like one helical structure, which starts from your material, then goes up to your working drawing. And if you can do this in the in the time frame that we have, I think students then know that, you know, if they did something wrong, Nietzsche, they can either they can go back, correct it, and come back. So this also gives them opportunities to self-reflect and to improvise, to correct, you know, because everything is linked. If we don't link it, then whatever we do in first year stays in first year, whatever we do in second year stays in second year. And by the time they come to third year, working drawings, or fourth year, sometimes you have to end up revising what was done in first year also. So maybe our problems, the design of our problems, need to follow a system which is all connected and linked. Next slide, please. You know, this is purely from experience. You may agree, you may not agree, you can refute, you can ask me to shut up on this. I feel that, you know, when we are teaching these students, especially construction, not just you know, other subjects also, but then if I'm talking about construction, we need to take them through the step-by-step methods. And I think I have had many discussions with the dean, SSA also, and many other on the faculty in Sushant School on this, that when the students come to us in first year, we have to actually do a lot of hand-holding and get them to a level where they start understanding our language, we start understanding their language. From second year, we should give them that opportunity to explore, and, you know, they should explore, do whatever within the limitation, and the faculty is there to check them, you know, okay, this is wrong, this is right, because they're still in second year. Third year should actually be more like a mentoring and guiding, that we are not teaching them, we are only guiding them, we're only mentoring them, they are doing their own exercise, they are understanding on their own. And fourth and fifth year, students actually become like professionals, so they become like colleagues. What you would discuss with a co-faculty, you should be able to discuss that with the students in the fourth year and fifth year also, because they have developed that kind of maturity to be able to understand what you're saying. And if we follow this system, so you see, you know, your role as a teacher changes from teaching to guiding, teaching to mentorship. And mentorship is extremely important in our system, because the student also have always, they have that connect. They know they can reach out to a person, so and so faculty, they can reach out to their mentor for any problem which may happen. So, you know, it's also about keeping students together. It's about having their confidence. They should be able to reach out to you anytime. And that is also part of the value system that we're trying to build in. That value is not always this one way. It's two ways. So when you expect them to do something, we should also be ready to, you know, go that extra mile for the students. Next slide, please. You know, this was, so how do you elicit student response? And this also answers the question that, you know, what is it the student look at, and why do they respect you, or why do they even think that you are approachable? If you could, you know, as a faculty, provide for a broad context of knowledge within which students can locate and understand their content, and, you know, they can find their own footing. So have a broad context of knowledge. You create learning environment in which students are encouraged to think carefully. You know, we're not getting judgmental about ki tumhe to aata hi nahi hai, tum kar nahi sakte, isse hoega hi nahi. You know, without getting into all those kind of things, or so and so is fantastic, uska dekho jaake. You know, somewhere we need to stop those comparisons, like what all psychologists tell you to not do in your house with your own children. We should be doing the same thing in the classroom also. Why should we be even comparing students like that? Maybe someone is good in a particular topic, someone is not good, someone is interested, someone is not interested. So, you know, maybe the same student can bounce back in the next session. So we don't have to judge. Then we have to confront and resolve. You know, this is something I feel is very important, that when students ask questions of us, even if we don't know, you know, we should be honest enough to say that, okay, I don't know, I can come back to you, or let's explore it together. Or we actually do a genuine exploration with whatever body of knowledge we have. We don't have to run away from it and say, no, no, tumhe to iski jurut nahi hai, or whatever. You know, a lot of times you try to get out of that uncomfortable situation also. So we have to demonstrate our commitment, responsibility, and our own willingness to take those risks. If we can demonstrate to students that, listen, this is how you take risks. I don't know about it, but let's find out. Let's do it. And if you know this is what they can do, then I think they will also pick up the same traits, and then they should be able to do it better.
Finished 1 hour, so you have other colleagues are there. They need to speak as well.
Yes. I'm sorry. So let's just move on to the next slide. I don't know how many slides are left. I think this is the last one. Yeah. So students respond if they see value. How does it happen? Be a valuable asset for the students, always available and approachable. And I know many faculty members in our college who are approachable at any time. You know, you can call them at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, or message them, and then they will respond. Value add to their knowledge without being critical or judgmental. I spoke about it. So do a deep dive, even if it is outside of the syllabus. You know, when you're explaining something about, let's say, DPC, explain everything that goes with it. Not just say ki ye first year mein itna hi sikhayenge, next year mein dusra sikha denge. If anybody is interested, that student will then pick it up and take it forward. Correlate with the current practices, current market practices, current practices, methodologies, whatever is happening. And, you know, last three things, if you read it very carefully, like explain as if there is no tomorrow. Probably the way I'm talking right now, I'm saying I want to tell you everything as if there's no tomorrow. But you need to do that with students, not necessarily with core faculty. Relate to them, understand their problems, understand the issues, the genuine issues, and then smile more often. You know, we should not be in grumpy mood. We should always be smiling. At least when it's always nice to see smiling faces in the class. And the last one, which is in red, is to change someone's mind. Stop talking and listen. I will stop now and listen. Thank you. That was it. That's long and short of it. Oh, the last slide says thank you for your patience and time.
We can let that be. How would we want this to happen? Would you want to take people, anybody wants to talk about this quickly? We can take five minutes.
Can I say something? I've been speaking for 1 hour. I'll just need 5 minute break. Maybe we can begin with the next session and we can have collective thing towards the end.
Yeah, so I think we can...
The question and answer session towards the end, yeah.
Sure. So Ashut, Amrita.
Ashut, you're going to go next, right?
Sorry, could you repeat?
You're going to go next, right?
Yeah.
Do you want to start? Should I put on your presentation or...
But she wants to, 5 minutes break. Let's have that. It's been a long session with him.
No, he's saying we continue. He'll come back to answer any questions later.
Okay. All right.
I'll just go and have a glass of water and then you can start, sir.
Okay. All right.
Great for everybody. Very difficult to have everybody together.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, sir, do you want me to present or are you going to just have a talk first?
I'll have a talk first and then request you for those slides.
Okay.
Okay. I'm going to share with you my experience in architecture, which is we date back to, you know, a long 1977. It was a different world in building construction, building industry for that matter. There were not much construction those days because there was not enough money in the market. All the projects largely used to be government funded projects. There was not enough money in the market. And when I started my career as an architect in 77, the cost of construction was rupees 80 per square foot of a very good level of construction, which is comparable to something like 1500 to 1600 rupees a square foot today. There were limitations. There were limitations in materials. You know, we largely dealt with quota stone, sandstone, marble. That's about it. Nothing more than that. Site works were very ordinary. Most of the material transportation, earthwork, was done manually, or donkeys were employed. That's because construction activity was very, very small. Industry was very, very small. Buildings also were very ordinary, unlike today, you know, when a lot of technical changes, technological changes have come about. You know, water supply was all by gravity in buildings. There were no pneumatic supply systems, hydropneumatic supply systems. In fact, in our times, we were not even taught air conditioning in our school. And because it was not a common thing at all, and it was not part of the syllabus. But when we came to the interest, came to the practice of architecture, my first project happened to be a 5-star hotel, and I learned about air conditioning. I'm talking about all these experiences because it's a sea of change from the time when I started my career in construction activity for what we have come to today. I've seen a vast, vast change in this industry. It was sometime in 1982 after the Asian Games and the ease of the economic program, economic policies of the country, that a big boom in construction came about. For the completion of the Asian Games, especially in Delhi, a lot of hotels, a lot of stadiums were completed, you know, in a short span of time with new technology and new methods of project management. And a big change in construction activity happened after that. Because of the, you know, economic boom, the change of policies and things like that, a lot of private promoters came into construction activity, building activity. A lot of housing projects started coming about, and sea of a change happened in building industry. I mean, just before that, I mean, when I started my career, a 5-star hotel, you know, which was built in about 2.5 years, a 200-room hotel cost about less than 20 crores of rupees. Compared to what it will be today, like, you know, maybe 150 crores, a 5-star deluxe hotel. That's the kind of change which has come about in last 40 years that I have experienced. Now, with this change, with this kind of money having come in, there had to be, you know, fair amount of control on the management of construction. Because the projects are large, the economic intervention is great. So the project management is utmost important. You know, you employ the contractor who has the labor to manage the works with. you have to supply him the materials, you have to order the materials well in time for to be executed, to be able to complete the works. So all these things require a project management team to be able to manage the works. I mean, you know, this is the industry underwent a lot of changes. So that is why I'm sharing this with you. Also, this activity in such a rush made look at alternative or alternatives for materials, because if you had to complete a project in a record time, you have to be able to manage the raw materials, the materials for completion. And the prevailing trends before the boom were not technologically that advanced. So people had to resort to new methodologies, new materials. I recall when we started working on a project in 86, where the builder promised that he would like to change the reputation of the builders by delivering on time without any cost escalations. It was on us to make sure that the project is completed on time. So we had to take the responsibility, and the contractor took the responsibility, and the builder actually signed agreement with his prospective clients, giving a fixed date that on this date the property will be delivered to you. So with this kind of a commitment, we had to be very careful, and we figured out that to be able to manage a project where we had to build about 375 dwelling units, complete with all the infrastructure, if we start ordering bricks now, it will take us probably 3 years to be able to manage the bricks. So that alternative at that time was not, that was not the material that we could go for. So as an alternative, we explored, and we finally decided to work with hollow blocks, which were actually produced at site. We tested them. We used these hollow blocks not only in walls, but in the floors and roofs also, which helped us save a lot of time, in the sense that we don't have to resort to any kind of shuttering to be able to do slabs. You span the joist across the beams and cover them with the blocks, and then put screed on it and finish with a floor finish. Same is the case with the roofing. We limited brickwork only to the wet areas like toilets and kitchens. A kitchen also only up to 3 feet height, not more than that. And idea being that we had to resort to new technology. We had to look to alternative methods to be able to overcome a problem. In fact, we had tried the same blocks on a limited scale only in 2 guest rooms of the hotel that I talked to you about in Agra. And they were tested for 200, almost like 15 years. We had no problems with those blocks. A company in Bangalore actually produced those blocks. Another project that I think will be of relevance to talk about here is, which I always wondered, Hall of Nations. It's actually a space frame built in RCC. I really admire the architect who took the challenges, because technology was not available to be able to do a steel space frame, which would have been the most ideal construction technology to use for a structure like that. If you look at this structure, can you imagine the shuttering, how the shuttering would have been managed? These are barely 1.2 meter long arms, and they're not more than 3.5 inches in 3.5 inches square. Managing steel bar bending in this, doing the shuttering and casting it, but it was achieved. The whole building actually spanned on four pylons, a massive structure. There are three or four pavilions like this. Unfortunately, this building is demolished. This is only to share with you the technological advancements that came about in short span of time that time. Now, it would be relevant to mention here that worldwide, large projects undergo major renovations as per the time demands. One such project is Wimbledon, where the roof was, where the roof covering was introduced on an existing structure, without really disturbing the architectural style and looks of the building. It's an amazing work. Now, with this kind of experiences, I think what I feel that we need to manage the students in education. I'll talk about what teachers need to do later, but first I'll talk about the students. We need to make them a little more interactive. They need to share with teachers a great deal more than they are doing right now. They need to improve their level of concentration in a class or in a session. And they need to learn to be self-critical. I mean, we'll have to teach them this, but we have to learn a methodology to make them, look at their work critically. Hard work, architecture actually is very demanding. It's very hardworking work. We have to get them out of their slumber, which happens very often. And they need to be honest. This is what I expect out of the students. But we as teachers need to be much more innovative, to be able to teach building construction to them, because it's a very interesting subject. It is not only interesting in terms of resolving, but it has design value to it. There's so much of designing involved with it. I think, how can you complete a building without detailing it out properly? A vision of an architect is complete only by completing it as he deems it. One part that I wish to share here on this platform is that this is has been my experience. The biggest problem we face teaching the students is their submission. We have to ensure that come what may, the submissions are made on time. Because it is the lack of submission which actually disturbs and makes the whole learning or teaching system, it disturbs it greatly. Because if students are left behind, losing classes after classes, it disturbs the entire teaching pattern. So we have to devise a method that a discipline must be maintained in delivery by the students. Everybody talked about building construction as a very important subject, but I'll tell you the state of affairs. We end up in building construction teaching the students mending their designs, teaching them building services which have been ignored while designing, teaching them structures while it has been ignored while designing. So we spend almost half a semester modifying their work to make it come to a level to start detailing it out in terms of building construction. And as it is, we are doing our session of teaching is half the session of what design is doing. So in real terms, we get only a quarter of what design gets in terms of real interaction for students to be able to deliver to what they are doing now. I think we need to seriously look at this. We need to have much more and a long session of 5 hours with a break is a long session in case if we can manage it better. I'll request Ashish to say his part.
Thank you, sir. So I'm going to talk about the attitude of the students and you know how the building construction as a subject is approached by them. Either they take it too lightly or you know how they're not able to gather its importance and what is their whole approach to this subject. So we've seen that, you know, as we've been, other speakers also have been talking over the days. Yesterday, Mr. Prakash also said that, you know, it's not, building construction is not independent. I mean, it's not a separate subject. It's the integral part of the design process itself. And this is what is basically the problem that students are not able to kind of relate that, you know, when they design, they're not designing in isolation independent of the material or the construction technology that they have to choose. But when they start doing building construction, then it becomes a different ballgame for them altogether. We need to kind of inculcate that habit in them that, you know, when you think about something, think in totality. We can't just be, designing something and then when it comes to construction detailing, then it happens is that how does that happen? How will this detail happen? Then we are stuck. Then they go back to the design board and then they start changing the design details and all that stuff. So the point that I'm trying to make is that, you know, we see after independence, post-independence Indian architects, the say like Kanwinde or Stein or, Shivnath Prasad, their buildings still retain a certain freshness or a certain contextual contemporary look if you compare to even more newer buildings that currently exist. And probably one of the reasons is that for them, the process of building construction or construction detailing wasn't separated from the idea of design. So when they would design, they would think about the thing in totality, not as a separate entity. And a good design will also, you know, kind of convince the norms related to construction, to functionality, to services. And what we see, what we are still seeing, I mean, what we should have gone beyond current context is that even though we are more mature as a country, as a society in terms of architectural education, we continue to make the same mistakes that probably are going on for a while in terms of services or construction detailing. So for example, you know, I don't know, since a lot of people here are from outstation and may not have seen the Huda City metro station that I take an example of, the drainage system of that is pathetic. The pipes are, they don't make any sense where they are flowing, where they are going. Half of them, the joints have come out because, you know, the fixing detail was not proper. So things like these are kind of still going on, whereas we should have gone much beyond that. And probably the reason for that is that there's too much focus on, you know, just that flashy design and not trying to work out total functionality as such. Then my other point is the student's approach to the subject in terms of time management and priority. So sometimes what we see as what Ashwini sir just finished with, that in most architectural schools, building construction is taken as a once a week, 5 hour studio at one go. So idea should be that because at 5 hours itself is a pretty long time for for the focus of the students to be retained, it becomes very difficult for them to get to work in the studio itself, which is very important, because once they go out, then their understanding, their learning is totally lost, because then they have access to all sorts of details that are available online or through books, which they just imitate without really understanding the detail. So probably the approach could be what even Ashwini sir said, that five hours instead, we could break it in two parts, say 2 hours of studio and 3 hours of, so 3 hours of studio and 2 hours of lecture, where what is explained to them theoretically is being done by them practically in the studio. So that anything that they, always I tell the students is that do whatever you do, but at least attempt it in your own understanding. Even if you're wrong, it doesn't matter. You're still in the learning phase. So it's fine. And the whole point is lost when these guys just imitate or copy or, just do anything that they get easy access to, which is not right, because then that understanding is lost. And I've had students tell me that, sir, how does it matter? Because ultimately, when we go in the profession, our basic work would be to design. And if we have our own offices, we will have people who will do the construction detailing for us. So it will really not matter. We need to get this attitude of the students, because, that chalta hai attitude doesn't work. We are in a very competitive society with the post-COVID challenges. And even before that, now everything, when things start going online, we will have our own challenges in terms of getting them to learn, because ultimately they are not in front of us. So again, that whole point of having easy access to something that they can easily just copy without understanding, that becomes much more. And if I related to what building construction was when we were studying, a lot of times we were actually made to do things on our own. Like Mr. Sanjay Prakash also yesterday said that he can do a brick wall himself. We were also told in a similar manner to, mix mortar, how to understand how the proportions are, calculated, how to even mix the whole process of mixing, what is put first, what comes next, how much water is to be added, what is the process. So that part probably is lost over the period of time that we did architecture, and now gradually what is happening. And this learning by doing is critical, because ultimately when these students become architects and they go to the sites, or in between when they actually go to offices to train again, then they realize that what they were lacking in terms of their drawings. But as soon as they go to sites, they are lost, because they don't know what to do. For them, everything is very simple, because they've done it on paper, so they think it happens like that very easily. Somehow in Indian context, that's not so easy, and it doesn't really work that way. So the point becomes more challenging. Now, if I were to just, kind of say that people these days are not giving adequate attention to building construction, then what happens is reciprocally, the faculty also becomes, that much more challenged, because ultimately they are trying to kind of complete the syllabus, because the time is very limited. Our studios are numbered. We can't really go beyond, take too many extra classes or try and get the students to do anything beyond the syllabus where they can probably get to learn more. And, that in turn pushes us to accept a lot of things which we would not otherwise do had there been adequate time, or we get enough opportunity to kind of make them do things and teach them. I have also realized that a lot of times when we have taken students to site, or to, even when I was teaching project planning and masters in interior architecture, I took my students to a site to show them how the project is planned, because it was at a project where the project planning is very critical and it's monitored by the developer very, very minutely. So ultimately it happened that the students got more interested into the whole building construction aspect of it. And what would have taken us 1 hour took actually 3 hours for the entire class, because they got so interested going to a site. And these were, mind you, master students. So it's not as if we are talking about bachelors who did not get an opportunity to go to the sites or not. So what I'm trying to say is that hands-on learning is very, very critical in today's time also, because it just gives another perspective to the whole teaching process. again, also then coming back to the teaching methodology. Now, when we teach, we have a, when we take submissions, we ask them to give submissions. Then again, they are under time pressure because they have design and they have structures and they have other subjects which they are already, you know, lagging behind. So the submissions are rushed up. Then when the submissions are rushed up, we don't have enough time. So we tend to do closed marking. Now, when we do closed door marking, ultimately we cannot, there are lots of things which the student needs to understand. By us marking on the sheets or giving them crits or comments or writing does not convey adequately the errors or the mistakes that they tend to make. So the closed door marking, in a way, it's our compulsion, but it does not help the student in many ways, because the student doesn't come to know what was the real mistake or how else can it be done. Because always I tell the students that, you know, building construction is not a unique solution problem. There are several approaches to building construction, and there may be many rights. There cannot be one right, there can be many rights. So if you attempt one and if someone attempts the other, it both may be right. It doesn't really, you know, you can't say this is better or that is better, because ultimately the point is that, you know, if both are successful and both are working and there are no failures in both the solutions, then we can't really tell them what is perfect and what is not. And these students are very, very, as for experience, as I say, is that they think that building construction is a very kind of a nightmarish subject. Yesterday, we had one student saying that, you know, she could not gather around doing building construction. So she approached Amrita. And then Amrita told her that, you know, how can you think of a design without material or without construction technology? Now, this is the whole perception problem, where, you know, if you start thinking in terms of a totality, then things work well. But if we are not able to connect, then, you know, the whole problem of these cosmetic treatments and just things failing. So just for example, that the fire in London, where a building got burnt, and then they realized that the ACP panels were the kind of carriers for the flames on for the entire building. So the whole of Gurgaon, all these buildings, especially with DLF, they had to rip up all the ACP cladding, and till date most of them have not found a solution to that, as to what is the alternate finish that they can do. Now they are stuck with they've removed the ACP panels, but the framing stuck. The framing is still there. They've just to kind of cover, they've painted it white to just make it look a little presentable. But at the end of the day, it's a failure. It's a total failure, because there was just a blind copying of a certain material, which may or may not be, you know, working in our context, or there could have been a different approach or option to it. So things like these really, make this whole approach very difficult for us. I just, you know, kind of prepared a small, you know, kind of a lighthearted sheet, which I would like to share. So I'll just share my screen. Is it visible?
Yes.
So this is what I could, you know, say that, you know, this is the design holding a knife to the building construction. Both are the same hand, and you know, building construction doesn't know what to do, but both are part of the same hand. They're not different. But ultimately, the students feel that design is what is more important, and the building construction is always under a threat. This is very interesting. There is a solution to the problem, but ultimately, of course, there could have been a better solution. But I mean, if you evaluate, the student will say, sir, this is working, so why not accept it? This is kind of a approach that, you know, we find that students just want to go and just do it in a way. It's like a, just get rid of the problem by doing any which way. Again, you know, some students will keep hoping for things to, you know, just happen, and they keep making the same mistakes, trying to fill a perforated bucket. They really don't, they don't aim, what is their basic aim, they don't think about that. This is another thing to convey, that, you know, a simple thing, you do something without realizing that, you know, if there is something that could have been, that is intended for a particular purpose, your approach to that, and that is just complete failure if you don't consider the basics. You had to just, you know, shift the whole the planter of around the tree, but instead the planters are where they are and the tree obviously can't shift. These are some classic examples that keep coming on the social media, and a lot of people would have seen. This is what will happen ultimately, you know, because people will end up just doing things which may look impractical, doesn't work. As architects, we really don't. I mean, though the building may be stationary, the building may work, but ultimately it's not a good practice, good design. Now, this is something that I want to, you know, always I show my students, that it's the same solution. It's the same thing. It's the same. But just by doing things on the same solution in a different manner, they've marked for people who are not in a rush, but just, and the other side, they have people who want to run to probably take a metro, run out to catch, to go to the office. So the same solution, but works differently for different people. And this is very classy, because ultimately we all have students who will try and find out the easiest way, you know, get the work done in any which way. So one of my students said, sir, aap mujhe kuch, I mean, I'm just using Hindi, a lot of people may not understand, but literally what he said is that you may teach me whatever, but I know I'll sail through, I'll be a successful architect. This is a classic jugaad, that this picture actually I took on my own. This is regularly seen on Gurgaon roads. And this is very symbolic of what happens in contemporary architecture with a lot of, I mean, now with the COA guidelines being challenged and non-architects being allowed to practice, this is what I think is symbolic of what our profession is all about. It's called, a jugaad, a tractor trolley converted into like a bus, and it moves at a snail speed. The maximum speed is 20 kilometers per hour, but people will still move on it, irrespective. And I have once actually asked the cops that, why don't you challan? He says, what do I challan it? What is the violation? And I have no answer, because he's saying it's a tractor trolley for me. And if there are people sitting there, it's just covered seating. This is classic, because, you know, a lot of times the students will do things, but they don't know what they are doing it for. So their detailing is all over the place. They will not know what comes first, whether the waterproofing will come first, or whether the tiling will come first, or under the sand, what goes first. So they are all over the place without just understanding, they just copy. So my whole point, things like these, you know, just asking people for, just copying sheets, changing labeling, doing it in their own handwriting. Now with online and AutoCAD drawings, it will all go again haywire. We've had cases where people have just picked up another student's entire file and just renamed, changed the name, the title block, and, you know, resubmitted it as their own work. But when you try and, ask them, they don't know anything. But ultimately, then it becomes a challenge for the faculty to try and to tell them that, we can't challenge that you've not done the work. But they have few things that you will generally ask, they will know. So the point is lost. Things like these, you know, these are very foolish, but these are again done by people. Someone has done them. And, you know, I mean, if there is a, I mean, I'm assuming that there are some things which are designed, but because people don't correlate design to a proper technology or technique or the way that things should be, they will end up doing things like these. I mean, even in today's time, look at the detailing here. I mean, and this was done by a very experienced architect, but what happens is that the architect probably had passed on to the student or about someone interning or a fresh architect, and they did not realize what will end up. But ultimately, it's a part of a multi-apartment complex where the user ultimately will suffer because it's a bad detail ultimately. So you can't get over things like these. They are stuck for life with all these things. I mean, this is a classic example where there is a ramp, there are steps, but I mean, both the things have been given together, so it doesn't serve the purpose at all. Both the things are fail on its own. So broadly, just summing up, and you know, because it's been a long day, I would just like to say that, you know, we need to think also from the perspective of the students and faculty, that students need to... Hello?
Stop presenting, Ashish.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is that the students need to be, you know, kind of the pressure needs to be removed to the students, like Himanshu Sanghani also said, which I also often do. I kind of make it lighthearted for them so that it becomes a learning experience rather than just a kind of a subject which is a binding for them to do and then they don't enjoy it. For me, I think architecture is also all about enjoyment. Unless you enjoy, you will not end up doing it well, or you will not put an extra effort to do that work. So we have to make the subject more and more kind of enjoyable, more lighthearted, kind of break it up, connect it to the design, or you know, just have a continuity from the design studio. Maybe after the design studio, there is a building construction studio, or vice versa, so that they carry on that learning and understanding, and then they are able to correlate both the things together without actually, you know, giving a break and without even treating them both separately. So I'd like to end with this, and we'll probably take some questions now.
Yeah, I think before anybody else jumps in with questions, on a lighter note, Ashish, almost like you said that, you know, we should only be teaching BC. Time nahi hai, ye nahi hai, wo nahi hai, enough nahi hai. Hum sirf BC padhate hain aapse. Kidding.
We can do that. See, I'll tell you why. Because, I mean, in a lot of these BC problems that we take up, there is a lot of design that is happening. Because ultimately, you know, when we are teaching BC, it's not that we can ignore the mistakes of design in that. So, for example, in the even semester in second year, which I was teaching now, there was the building that also needed to be designed. Now, a lot of time was lost in the design process itself. So, ultimately, we were rushing up to basically teach them the construction details, which was the core motive of the semester. So, that's what I'm saying. It has to be. I mean, as BC faculty or BC subject, we can't be ignoring design mistakes. We can't be allowing design mistakes.
Even Mr. Khair talked about it. We earlier discussed this in Prashansa's session. We talked about it in various forms. That so here you know what he talked about was that cross semester learning. So if I do a design in one semester in a traditional design scenario, then Okay. So if we do design in that traditional scenario, ek semester mein design kiya, next semester mein uski BC kari, there's a lot of time. What's going on? Okay, so the discussion goes. So yeah, so if you are doing design in one semester, we shouldn't be looking at actually doing the construction detailing of it in the next semester, because in the next semester, we lose a lot of time trying to resolve the issue of the design before we get to the intent of the studio. So that is, you know, one thing that comes out of it. But the other thing that comes out of it is also, and I would bring back to what Shiv was talking about, and Shiv talked about the four stages of of so to say first year on to fourth year, when he talked about hand-holding, exploring, mentoring and professionals, I would really like Shiv to come in over here, because to me it seems that if you are actually asking somebody to do if you're just going to do hand-holding in the first year, you're not actually going to make them problem solvers with the material. How do you actually then say, now you only go till here in the next semester, in next year, and you don't actually take this, you know, material all the way to its understanding, or this detail all the way to its understanding? Maybe that is not the way to approach the four semester years. Maybe the approach is to actually do all of these four steps in every semester, and then design is built in.
See, we could we could I'll just bring in 2-3 points. One is that we can always do all the four steps together, but that needs some kind of time. You know, you can't say ki is hafte mein hamara handholding ho gaya, agle hafte mein mentoring ho gaya, and next week we are talking about something else. So students, why I said first year, because first year these children are raw, they don't know anything about architecture, and we need to actually handhold them on everything that they do. So we can even talking about materials, we can actually tell them, because that's, you know, when you're discussing material, then it's only materials, discussing properties of material. And if you go back to that play field graphic which I had shared, so maybe first year this part refers to the southwest quadrant, which is more like classroom teaching and you know, the traditional method of teaching, with some hints of experiential learning thrown in. Ki unko material dikha diya, kuch kar diya. But as we move on, agar, you know, when we move on to the second year, they start exploring it much more than what they were doing it. Of course, that doesn't mean that first year mein exploring karenge nahi. So when you're doing hand holding, maybe if I were to rephrase my sentence, I would say that first year you should be doing probably 70% handholding or 60% handholding, and then you do 20-30% exploration, and then you do 10-15% of guidance and mentoring, and forget about professionalism right now. We take that to the next year. So again, these mixes is something which we need to agree upon, and we may work, may not work for some situations, but then I think that is a debate all about.
You know what, I was asking this question is also in context to this understanding of materials that we bring into the picture, right? Say first year mein ye materials hone chahiye, second year this is the kind of materials we should do. We sort of imagine that those sort of materials are a matter of increasing complexity, right? We imagine that concrete is the most complex of materials. Hence, it can only be handled in the fourth year or the third year, right? We imagine brick to be a simple material, so that's a separate discussion, maybe about which material is more complex and which materials
doesn't work, Amrita, because if you look at the first year syllabus, even as of now, when you are talking about brickwork, you do talk about PCC. First year mein foundations are there, so foundation ki baat karte ho, so you do talk about you know, kind of, or at least types of foundations, which could be your isolated footing, which could be raft. You just talk about them, and so maybe as you go on the fourth semester or something, that is when you start increasing the complexity. So first year when we're talking, we talk about that. Of course, we will not talk about IS 456 in the first semester when you're talking about material,
but you don't talk about brick in the fourth year, do you? At all?
Of course we do.
I mean, in terms of how a wall is made,
yes we do. That's what I'm saying, because there has to be so much of correlation. That in that is what I was saying earlier, that even in third year, second semester, I end up sometimes talking about DPC, I end up talking about coping, I end up talking about brick on edge, because if you don't understand, you know, how they are relating now to, let's say, to plinth protection, how is the plinth protection getting anchored in the building, what happens to plinth beam, so you still have to talk about these things. Of course, that you're not talking about English bond, Flemish bond, that has been done and dusted with, but then you have to take these lessons from previous years, and then you have to keep applying them. You can't just forget about them. So similarly, so even in the syllabus, when we talk about it, when you're talking about materials, then why do we say that material of concrete and steel will not be talked in the first semester? You expose them to everything, and then uske baad with levels of complexity as it increases we keep raising the bar. We don't have to say okay ab brick upar pahunch gaya and now we stop, now we take this further. It should not be done by silos.
Precisely the point. I mean, this is a huge syllabus rejuggling, literally.
I also just want to throw my two bits in, basically, because coming from where we look at it in design, we do what we call the first year and unlearning. So the foundation course, I feel, is a lot of experiential. And if you think about experiential, then I think the first semester, if one is looking at or the foundation course of our BIAC program, they should be just touching, feeling, putting together, breaking, literally playing with all the different materials. And that might be a great place to start from, and where one just all the different materials and not restricted to A, B, C, D. We have just about everything.
What Shiv has been saying, that you don't discard a material at a particular stage, that now you've already learned about it and now you can forget about it, because it's also the maturity of using that material, how you end up using it. So for example, I'll give you an example which always was talked about, that when IHC Delhi was built, and Mr. Stein was not very happy with using the regular size brick, so ultimately they decided to go in for a completely new size of brick. And that is the kind of maturity for the same material that they actually went up and because obviously they are star architects, so they were at a level totally different level. But with the same material, they could actually go into a new size of the brick altogether. And similarly, a normal brick used at IIM Ahmedabad, they say that the material itself, the brick itself, has been used to such efficient use that not a single brick had to be cut. So this is what happens, that the students need to be able to feel confident about the material, not just go by the conventional use or size or the way books tell them, because that's the only way they will end up experimenting, not only by design but also by the material itself.
There's this I'll just taking from what Ashish just said. We have been doing a lot of work in exposed brickwork, because that's probably than all architects, you all like it. We were doing these schools, and which you also read out in my bio earlier, doing a lot of replicable stuff and for rural education initiative. So we were doing these schools, which were small school, which had to come up in different places, and you obviously cannot afford to go wrong in detailing and in terms of sizing. So there were these two windows, and there's a little brick pillar in between the two windows. And in exposed brickwork, normally as an architect, you would say, okay, two window ke beech mein, let's do 450. So my counterpoint there was that because this is an exposed brickwork, can you do 450 brickwork? Again, the same thing. So you'll have to cut the brick. So let's do it as 230 plus 230, 460 rakhte hain usko, aur 460 mein, then you can stagger it and do whatever. And then so you kind of detail that out, do a little part elevation or a part section, say this is how it's going to be done. And if you are aware, and this is even I'm telling you, this is in when you are actually in profession, agar ye cheez hum ye not thinking hum usme dal sake ki you should be able to think about all these materials even at fourth year level or third year level when they're making their working drawing. They understand, they imagine the material the way it is, rather than just calling it hatch, double hatch and brickwork 236. So that level of awareness can gradually be built in, and they need to be at a very elevated level. They should understand, they should be on top of the materials. So first year do something, second year do something, get them to a level which is where it is very complex. So even building like Laurie Baker has done, they're very complicated to understand. If you understand the material, then they're very simple. But even to do a rat trap bond, the way when the building is also turning around, it has a curvature, it's a very tough thing. So I think we have to take the students through this journey. And that's why, coming back to Amrita's question, I said that, there could be these four stages, hand holding, and then you guide them, and then you finally make them professionals. And one stage in between is with exploratory. Yep.
So I think we'll take a question that that Reema, I think, has posted over here. She's talked, do you mean that we should teach materials through construction processes rather than just teaching about materials as just materials? Responses to that, please.
I wouldn't isolate it so simply, because obviously there will be some materials whose knowledge may be required to be had by the student, but the usage may not be immediate or may not be relatable for the student there itself, or maybe during the course of the study at all altogether. So to totally, you know, segregate them, or to you know, say that, you know, the entire material education should be through building construction may not work. But yes, a lot of materials that are a part of the regular construction process could be integrated with that entire teaching.
It is sorry. Please go ahead.
No, I was just asking one of you to come in. So go ahead.
Actually, you know, for the time that I spent in the college, till the third year, I have not seen many complete elevations of a design building where materials are specified. So learning about materials is limited only to the construction, to the basic civil construction materials, and not to the finishing materials. So we have a limited work on. Now, say for example, we do working drawings in third year. We hardly take up finishing works. The finishing works are limited to toilet detailing, pantry detailing, or flooring detailing. But in terms of elevations, the building treatment, not many students, or very few, I would say, experiment with different materials. I have been suggesting that working drawings that we do in third year in building construction, we should actually replace that by doing tender drawings, instead. I'd like to, share the difference between the working drawings and the tender drawings. Tender drawings actually mean that the entire finished building is to be presented, where you need to specify materials for each and every surface. Whereas the working drawings actually serve very little purpose. Because of the shortage of the time, the amount of work that they have to produce, we do not get to do too much of detailing of the working drawings. It is a must, they must learn how to do it. But we have one semester in fourth year where I think, one could definitely have this looked into. And for better experience with materials, introduce tender drawings in the third year instead of the working drawings.
There is a question by Alpi also here. Do you think that students should be taught to learn about many materials or techniques, and should they be equipped to take on projects independently soon after they complete the course? Sir, Ashwini sir, Ashish, Shiv, would you want to answer?
I have just replied to that second part of the question, that we'll actually be failing if we can't give students enough confidence for starting on their own after they finish the course. It's a five year long course and professional course. Agar 5 saal ke baad bhi wo kuch apna nahi kar sakte and they're not confident enough, then I think somewhere something is lacking. That is the ultimate litmus test of the college, the students, the teachers, everybody put together, the syllabus, the lesson plan, everything. That if your students who graduate after 5 years, they have to have the skills to start on their own. If not the marketing skills, but then definitely technical skills. You can't go wrong with that.
No, I agree with Shiv because Shiv, please continue.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just adding to what you were saying that, you know, ultimately then what happens is then when people actually make an effort, some of them do are able to start. So there then they have
Ashish, I think you lost your voice. Hello.
Yeah, I think Ashish, we can't hear you. For a moment, I thought I lost my network.
Even I thought so.
So Shiv, could you just continue with what you were saying? Then we can.
I think that is very clear that we need to equip our students with enough skills. They should get out and they should be on their own, or they, if they want to, or they should add value to whichever office they go and decide to work with. Second, the first part of the question was that they should be taught, whether the students should be taught to learn about material and techniques. I think that is what we've been talking all this while, that the students, when we introduce them to different material, they have to, it's not just the material, but with materials goes the processes also. I think what Ashish also was talking earlier before he went offline was that materials and the processes, they go hand in hand. So somewhere materials take something like design and construction, so somewhere materials take precedence, somewhere the techniques take precedence, somewhere even the sizes. For example, if somebody is doing a flooring design and you're putting Kota stone, and if you don't know that Kota stone, you only get a maximum size 550 by 550, you need to know that information. So you need to know the material, you need to know about the size in which it's available in the market, and then of course you need to know how it's fixed. So construction processes and the construction material, they need to be taught together. Or if not taught, I would say the students have to be encouraged to get this information on their own, or ask faculty, go out, go to the sites. Again, construction, importance of site visits, and finding out about and doing this market survey is extremely important. You can't just study in a cocoon and in a closed environment without getting this knowledge.
Just jumping in here, would you say that if you say about material, there are infinite materials. So is it even possible that we are able to, like, it's like Alpi's specific, she's mentioned is many.
The material, there are so many materials.
Sorry, but because it's related to what I was going to say, I thought this is a good point to bring in, this element of what you said, material is has not been same forever. We've been using bricks since Harappan times, okay? So we are using bricks now, and we are we teach bricks as though it was discovered by McKay. So in the scheme of things where, you're looking at process, I mean, we're also making political decisions about which process are we promoting in the studio and why. We need to reflect on that. And I also think we need to reflect on the history of construction. And we've been, in Sushant, we've been, working very hard on integrating the curriculum so that, history has started to take the kind of the role of teaching students construction history. Structures has taken on the role of teaching students material behavior. And I just want to ask you how, what you know, can building construction studio take some of that onus of contextualizing materials that we teach before we teach them, and starting from, you know, the first day, because students need to know where is this coming from, why are we learning this, what is at stake in terms of energy consumption, in terms of how it's produced, in terms of, you know, whether we need to radicalize it, because, you know, Mangalore tiles is made of the same material as the brick, but it's a completely, it's the same material but different process, and why is it different? And so all those questions that make students develop a relationship with the material, like Sanjay was saying yesterday, SP was saying yesterday, that, you know, how many, you know, have lifted a brick, and Hossein was saying that as well. So how many have lifted the brick and felt it, and, you know, how many have got their hands itchy because they have, you know, played with concrete without wearing gloves. And these are experiences that, you know, we as students probably had, and we're not giving them enough. So I wanted your views on this, Shiv maybe, and Ashish.
Yeah. See, I agree with you on the fact, and that's what we've been saying, that building construction is not just a subject by itself. So building construction also aids, ultimately leads to your design and whatever is your creative manifestation. Same thing is with history, same thing is with services, structures, all the subjects ultimately take you towards that